Hello everyone, I'm one of the presenters, Yu Kyung Kwan. Dr. Lee and I are going to present the findings, issues on assessment dementia and caregiving for Korean American elders. Today's presentation will cover several topics, as you can see in this slide. First, I'm going to present on Korean American and its background. Dr. Lee will present the next two sections, dementia in Korean Americans and issues related to dementia in Korean Americans. And I will take turn again to present an assessment of dementia and Korean family caregivers for dementia patients. First, who is Korean American? I will briefly summarize Korean American demographics and the characteristics of Korean culture. Then I will introduce Korean American family system and values in transition and current Korean elders in the United States. Versus demographics. Korean Americans are the fastest growing subgroup of Asian Americans. In 2000 census, over 1 million U.S. residents identified their race as Korean. There have been several waves of immigration of Korean Americans to the United States. Korean immigration has begun in the late 19th century, and Korean laborers were recruited to the Hawaiian sugar plantations in the early 1900s. However, it was only after the passage of the Immigration and Naturalization Act of 1965, the Koreans immigrated to the United States in substantial numbers. Especially the number of Korean elders increased 20-fold from about 3,000 in 1970 to 67,000 in 2000. The increase of older Korean population is due to a substantial increase in the immigration of elderly Koreans and also the aging of younger Korean immigrants admitted in 1960s and in 1970s. It is the fast-growing age group, now constituting 6.8% of the Korean-American population. The Korean Americans have a relatively short history of immigration to the United States, but the 2000 census suggests that the population has become more diverse. The proportion of Koreans born in foreign countries decreased from 73% in 1990 to 65% in 2000. The proportion of low English proficiency dropped from 52% in 1990 to 28% in 2000. Korean Americans showed one of the highest levels of educational achievement. For example, in 2000, 49% had at least a bachelor's degree compared to the national figure of 27%. However, still the majority of the Korean Americans continue to speak Korean at home. Korean American elders are quite different from their younger generation. Majority of older Korean Americans still foreign born. They are likely to have limited English proficiency. About half of the Korean elders are linguistically isolated. Also, Korean elders have lower educational attainment. 45% did not graduate from high school. 23% completed high school, and the remaining 32% had some college education. Next is characteristics of Korean culture. First of all, the importance of blood relatives cannot be overstated, especially among traditional Korean elderly. Korean people often feel an important kinship with even relatives they have never met. The importance of blood ties makes up a foundation for characteristics of Korean culture. Before going in more detail, I would like to say that these cultural beliefs or characteristics may not represent the Korean population in the United States. The cultural values and characteristics are the ones that have been found in Korean or traditional Korean-American families. First, there is a strong tradition of filial piety, so-called hyo in Korean. Korean caregivers' motivations are primarily based on filial responsibility. It usually includes three core values. First, respect for parents. Second, family harmony. And third, sacrifice for parents. Second, there are clearly divided family roles. Usually, primary caregivers are daughters-in-law of the firstborn sons. Third, family collectivity and interdependence frequently overrides individualism and independence. In caregiving situation, the emphasis on harmonized relations may influence caregivers not to receive formal services for a demented parent. They will be afraid that family cohesion may be disrupted by non-family members' involvement into their family responsibility. As said in the previous slide, the Korean Americans are diverse in terms of family system and values. Korean immigrant families have experienced challenges to adjust to the United States culture, and they have been more accepting of the American values and practices. This means they are more likely to challenge the traditional norms of Korean families, such as extended family, family care of elders, and familism. Even though recent studies of Korean immigrant families show general departure from traditional family values and acceptance of American values, we need to look at the changes more carefully. Some Korean Americans may experience internal conflict in selecting one value over another, while other Korean Americans can balance between the two cultural values. There is a lack of a representative national study on the family values and practices in Korean American population, and existing study is not conclusive on value change and its impact on Korean Americans' health and well-being. In practice or research, acculturation level or adherence to cultural values need to be considered carefully. For Korean elders in the United States, I'm going to focus on two topics: their health beliefs and their health-related behaviors. Again, relatively little information is available with regard to health status and health care of Korean American elders in the United States. The beliefs stated here are true for most traditional Koreans. They are less true of more westernized or acculturated Koreans, but are still likely to have a strong influence. Also, please remember that this information is not limited to Korean elders with dementia or their families, but applies to general health and health care of Korean American elders. First, many Koreans may prefer hanbang or hanyak, which mean oriental medicine, as the preferred method of healthcare. Korean patients may alternate between practitioners of Western medicine and traditional Korean medicine. Next, Koreans have described spiritual causes of illness if they do not meet their spiritual being's expectation of them, whether they are related to Christianity, animism, shamanism, or Confucianism. Korean elderly patients may follow Buddhist or Confucian doctrine, viewing illness and death as a nature part of life. Symptoms may be seen as a bad luck, misfortune, or the result of karma, pay back for something they did wrong in the past. Illness is often conceptualized as a lack or interruption of the flow of life energy, such as a lack of regularity, control of daily patterns of living, lack of control of food intake, lack of blood, or coldness and dampness inside the body. An interesting culture construction of illness is huabyeong. It is literally translated as fire illness. This is listed in DSM-4 as culture-bound syndrome. The cause of this illness is suppressed anger or intolerable tragic situations. Symptoms of huabyeong include a perceived stomach mass, palpitations, heat sensation, flushing, anxiety, and irritability. Most Korean women in parent or grandparent generation are familiar with huabyeong, and majority may report they have experienced it. In most cases, it is likely to be related to difficult interpersonal or family relationships. Third, because of a strong orientation towards own family, many Koreans are more likely to believe their family or family friends' view of their illness rather than that of the physician or other professionals. Like other minorities, Korean American elders reportedly do not utilize the U.S. healthcare system. Many factors combine to make older Korean American immigrants reluctant to use the U.S. healthcare system. These include language problems, unfamiliar systems, unfamiliar food in hospitals, and their own traditional health beliefs. Many Korean elders do not understand the U.S. healthcare system and do not speak or understand English. Even when there are a number of Korean Americans living in the community, the availability of Korean language speaking healthcare providers is very limited. Hospitalization may be especially undesirable because of separation from family, preference for traditional medicine, the lack of Korean food. Most Korean American elders eat Korean food at home. In one study by Zhang and others, health insurance coverage was found to be a significant enabling factor for hospital visits. A greater likelihood of satisfaction was found in individuals with health insurance, better English speaking ability, and greater trust in Western medical care. Korean Americans come to their friends and family or churches or temples to seek information, care, and support. Especially Korean churches provide the most important support system in the United States. They may greatly facilitate getting older people the help that they need. Most Koreans prefer methods perceived to be natural ways of improving health, such as diet, eating natural foods, and by walking around their home or in the park to get fresh air. In addition, they reuse traditional oriental health practices to prevent them from becoming ill.
Hey, all right, this is John DeMario again. I just want to let you know that we'll be presenting Dr. Lee. We'll be taking the presentation now.
Hi, I'm Dr. Sang Lee, and today I'm going to talk about Section 2 and 3 of webinar presentation. In Section 2, I'm going to cover prevalence of dementia in the Korean-American population, Korean-American caregivers, awareness about dementia care services, and how can we promote service use in the population. First, prevalence of dementia. Limited information about ethnic-specific prevalence rates of dementia is available. For example, African Americans, Hispanics, and older Japanese American men in Hawaii. Unfortunately, no Korean American specific data about prevalence is available. Our best guess is that due to the expected rapid increase in minority elders, particularly Hispanic and Asians, the number of those affected by dementia from ethnic minority will increase dramatically, including Korean Americans. There are few studies about prevalence rates of dementia in Koreans in Korea. The rates are from 7.4% to 13%, which are generally higher than other countries, including the United States. So the bottom line is that although we know that there are difficulties in recruiting and retaining minority for dementia research, there is an urgent need to assess the accurate prevalence rates of dementia in various minority groups. Korean American caregivers. The exact profiles of Korean American dementia caregivers are not much known, although we can assume that family is still considered the main source of assistance and care to old adults in the Korean culture. There are few qualitative studies of Korean American caregivers in general, and I think those studies provide us with some insights about challenges and needs of Korean American caregivers, including dementia caregivers. In the previous section, Dr. Kwan covered changes in family systems and values, including gender roles, family relations, and filial responsibility. Because of those characteristics of life as immigrants, there are variations among Korean American caregivers about traditional norms toward elder care. For example, those who still strongly believe that children, or at least the family, should take care of their elderly parents, versus those who are open to utilize outside help. Although there are indications of values in transition, many caregivers at the same time expressed uneasiness about sending their care recipient to nursing home. The concept of nursing home is new to many Koreans, especially for elders. And it also conflicts with the long-standing tradition of respecting and caring for their aging family members. While they were ambivalent about using formal services and only thinking of it as a last resort, they expressed the needs for outside assistance with many caregiving activities. For example, many caregivers identified a lack of information about what to do or what not to do as one of the most important challenges, and they said that mostly they learned those tasks by themselves. Awareness about dementia care services. Korean Americans, both lay people and caregivers, showed extremely low awareness about dementia care-related services like recipe care, dementia daycare center, Alzheimer's Association caregiver helpline, and caregiver support group. In research with the mainstream population, not knowing about available services is one of the main reasons dementia caregivers did not use services. Additionally, information about illness and resources and opportunity to talk with other caregivers are identified as the highest needs among dementia caregivers. Looking at the characteristics of these less-known services, we can know that they have the potential to satisfy caregivers' most unmet needs. In other words, there is a great need for raising community awareness about available services, and special outreach effort about available services would be beneficial for current and future dementia caregivers of Korean Americans. Having the background information just presented, we can think about how to accommodate Korean American caregivers' reluctance to use formal services and their pressing needs for outside help. We know that values are changing, but families still want to be the backbone of caregiving. At the same time, they need help. So when discussing and promoting service use in dementia care with Korean American population, it would be appropriate to approach older clients and families without threatening family values and relationship. It would be also appropriate to address the fact that family care can continue to be the preferred option while using formal services which can complement family caregiving and not substitute for it. It needs to be emphasized that formal services can assist caregivers to continue to support people at home by giving caregivers a break and decreasing caregiving hours. Therefore, they can allow family to maintain filial responsibility by alleviating some pressure on them and eventually helping the family to continue to care for elders within the family in a higher quality manner. In the third section of this presentation, I'd like to talk about issues related to dementia when working with Korean-American population, including selecting appropriate terms, beliefs, and knowledge about dementia. Findings I'm going to share in this section is from one of my research projects with Korean-American population. Which term to use? Both in research and practice, the terms dementia and Alzheimer's disease are interchangeably used, and from time to time, I am asked by practitioners and other researchers about which term would be more appropriate, preferable, or recognizable in the Korean-American population. Here, I can share some research findings which you can consider in choosing a right term for your own purpose and setting. This data is from a study of 209 middle-aged and older Korean-Americans in Los Angeles area. It shows that, I'm going to use the arrow here. Okay. It shows that 100% of study participants had heard of dementia compared to 82% had heard of Alzheimer's disease. Not surprisingly, older Korean Americans showed less awareness about the term Alzheimer's disease, which is 72%. In the same study, it was further asked whether dementia and Alzheimer's disease are same, different, one type of dementia, or don't know, and over a quarter of older participants reported that they don't know the answer. So it appears that Korean Americans were more familiar with dementia rather than the diagnostic label of Alzheimer's disease. Knowing this, you can use your discretion in selecting a term depending on purpose of choosing a term, your work setting, and serving population. For example, if you're working with general Korean American population, which is more of the preclinical stage, dementia may be more recognizable than Alzheimer's disease. When you are in a clinical setting, Alzheimer's disease would be a more correct way to describe the illness. In the next few slides, I'm going to talk about beliefs about dementia in Korean-American population, including stigmatization, culture acceptance, and culture beliefs. I want you to keep in mind that I'm going to talk about these topics because they are related to barriers to timely diagnosis and treatment and using supportive social services in current and potential dementia situation. First, stigmatization of dementia as insanity. The majority of Korean American immigrants hold a strong stigmatizing view of dementia as insanity. As you can see in the slide, 75% believe so, and this rate is much higher than other racial ethnic groups like 40% of African Americans and 10% of white older adults believe that dementia is a form of insanity. The Asian culture norm of face-saving considers exposing negative family events as shameful and embarrassing and avoid public disclosure of those events. Under this cultural influence and stigma attached to dementia, Korean American families may recognize signs of dementia in their relatives, but may not want to seek outside help in an attempt to avoid community awareness and stigmatization. This stigma of dementia and fear of public disclosure were reported as significant barriers of seeking evaluation and services in other Asian American dementia caregivers. Culture acceptance. Many Korean Americans considered memory loss to be a part of the aging process. For example, 84% believe that memory problems and associated behaviors are normal consequences of growing old. Although not majority, still 38% believe that dementia is a normal part of getting old. This view may stem from Asian culture norms that old age is a period of mental and physical deterioration, and memory problems are generally expected to occur. Under this cultural acceptance, many Korean American immigrants are likely to perceive memory loss, which can be signs of initial dementia symptoms, as natural and delay seeking medical evaluation until the disease reaches a later stage. Studies of Alzheimer's disease caregivers of other ethnic minorities support this possible phenomenon, and they reported that caregivers considered initial symptoms as normal and sought formal evaluation only after they encountered crisis events and functional disability. Social cultural causal attribution. As in the mainstream population, dementia can be explained from biomedical perspectives in Korean Americans. At the same time, non-biomedical explanation, which are more social cultural explanation, exist in Koreans. For example, 75% attributed dementia to physical and social inactivity when elders live alone, and 61% attributed dementia to introvert and passive personality. On a positive note, this is promising in that Korean Americans believing these attributions will presumably try to maintain more physically, mentally, and socially engaging lifestyle to prevent dementia. And their growing scientific evidence suggests that physical activity and social engagement may be beneficial to cognitive health. On a negative note, however, these attributions can result in blaming persons with dementia for bringing on the illness by not maintaining a stimulating living environment or having certain kinds of personality. Therefore, clinicians and providers of healthcare and social services who are generally trained in biomedical framework should also consider the social cultural aspect of dementia when working with Korean Americans. We can continue to promote physical, mental, and social activities. At the same time, we need to be aware of potential negative aspects of dementia attributions and incorporate it in our practice when necessary, so family members and patients are not engaged in unnecessary blame. Another interesting finding here in relation to social culture attribution is that similar to other Asian American caregivers like Chinese and Vietnamese caregivers, many Korean Americans interpreted dementia as a result of troubling life experience, such as emotional trauma and social relationship problems. Particularly, they identified Korean culture concept of Han as a cause of dementia. Han can be explained having unresolved personal, family conflicts, lifetime hardship, or issues that cannot be shared with others. These attributions can lead to stigma, shame, and embarrassment on the family, believing that dementia is a result of personal failure of those who had a negative family experience, personal experience. That can make them hesitate to disclose a condition to those outside the family. While respecting these cultural attributions, efforts need to be made to keep them from interfering with taking advantage of early diagnosis, available medication, and supportive services. Last thing I'd like to touch in relation to issues related to dementia in Korean American population is their knowledge about available treatment. Only 31% knew availability of medication to delay progression of dementia, and 43% knew medications to control behavior symptoms. At the same time, 64% correctly knew that there is no cure for dementia at present. In other words, sketchy knowledge about dementia treatment combined with correct knowledge about cure can be another barrier to medical and social service use. Many Korean American immigrants might not feel a need to visit a doctor and receive a medical diagnosis even after detecting signs of dementia. So extensive efforts should be made in disseminating that even if the illness cannot be cured, the available medications for dementia along with early recognition can slow the deterioration process and enhance the well-being of persons with dementia and their caregivers. Now I'd like to hand it off to Dr. Kwon for remaining sections.
Before, this is John DeMario. Before Dr. Kwan starts her part of the presentation again, I just want to remind folks that if you have any questions that you would like to ask the presenters, you're welcome to use the chat window, which is located on the bottom left of the screen, and you can enter your question in. You're welcome to just, there's a little text box on the very bottom, right above the button that says "To Everyone." So there's a little box there. We can type your question. You can ask it, and I will see it, and I will, either if it's appropriate to answer it right away, we'll answer it right away, or we'll wait to the very end when we will take questions and answers then, too, as well. But it wouldn't hurt to ask the question now, and then we'll know about it and try to answer it appropriately. All right, and here's Dr. Kwan.
Hi. This section, we cover assessment of dementia with the Korean population. This section will include recent development of dementia assessment tools for Korean population, Korean version of mini-mental state examination, and examples of assessment of dementia for use in Korean population. Lastly, issues in assessment of dementia with the Korean population. First, there is a growing trend of research in neuropsychological assessment in Korea, along with other Asian countries, for the purpose of screening and diagnosis of dementia or related disorders in elderly population. First of all, recent therapeutic advances to delay the progression of dementia have renewed calls to improve early detection and management of individuals with dementia. In recent development of dementia assessments, the developers are more mindful that the entire battery needs to be brief and applicable to a poorly educated elderly population. The development of assessment tools basically followed the stages of direct translation, adaptation of Western instruments, and the construction of original assessment tools. As tests are translated or adapted for use in Korean population, the issue of cross-culture validity arises. In other words, social and cultural factors affect some aspects of test performance. I am going to give one example as an evidence that cultural differences beyond simple demographic factors may affect performance of older adults on verbal fluency task. One verbal fluency task asked older Korean adults to generate items found in a supermarket. Often Korean clients do more poorly on this verbal fluency task than counterpart US adults of same age and same educational background. They are slower, poor retriever made due to their limited familiarity with supermarkets, which are not the primary shopping venues of Korean older adults. Based on new research findings and increased recognition of the impact of cultural factors, most of recently adapted assessments work on clinically validating their items and administration procedures, often including replacing original items with culturally relevant ones and establishing new norms for Korean elderly population. Mini-mental state examination is most widely used for the assessment of cognitive functioning for Korean elders too. The original MMSE was translated and modified into two Korean versions. One is called MMSE-K and another is called K-MMSE. These versions can give a perfect example of how... I will repeat the previous sentence. I'm sorry. These two Korean versions can give a perfect example of how the original assessment was adapted to be appropriate for Korean population. I'm going to focus on one version, MMSE-K, today. You can check out another version, K-MMSE, in the bibliography we provided. There were two purposes of the modification. First, there was an urgent need to develop neuropsychometric measures that can sensitively and specifically identify people with cognitive impairment in non-Western, non-English, only Korean-speaking population. Second, there were a number of intrinsic problems with which made it difficult to use with people with low education and illiteracy. The illiterate cannot perform two of the original MMSE test items. One was to write a sentence about anything, and another was to read the written instruction of close your eyes. These are the test items of the MMSE-K. In the original MMSE, the item 10 is close your eyes. It was changed to comprehension test. Why do people wash their clothes? Any response regarding hygiene was considered correct and given a score of 1 point. The original test item 11 here was originally write a sentence about anything, which was changed to a judgment item. How can you give an identity card back to the owner if you find it on the street? Here the item 7 was originally to repeat no ifs, ands, or buts, but which was changed to a Korean phrase. And word WORLD in spelling backward in the original item 4 was changed to Samcheolli Gangsan, which means All Korea Beautiful, and is five-syllable word. MMSE-K contains 30 possible points like the original MMSE. In scoring, the response is by the lunar calendar to the first item, orientation in time, are also correct because the lunar calendar is widely used among Koreans. In the Park and Kwon's study on the validation of MMSE-K, education was the only variable influencing scores. So the raw MMSE-K score was corrected for education by adding 1 point to the score on orientation in time, 2 points to the score on concentration calculation, and 1 point to the score on language function of non-educated individuals. However, the corrected score should not be more than the possible maximum score in a given sphere. For scoring, another study estimated the optimal cutoff score for MMSE-K for screening of dementia in community-dwelling old people and possible changes of the cutoff score according to age, gender, educational level, living area, and depression of the old people. In the older people 65 and over, the optimal cutoff score on MMSE-K served by clinical diagnosis of dementia was 21-22. Age was significantly related to the cutoff score on MMSE-K. The author suggested the optimal cutoff score in those ages 75 or over was to be 20-21. This study suggests community healthcare staff can use demographically or culturally appropriate cutoff score on MMSE-K for screening of dementia as a guideline for assessing old people with questionable cognitive dysfunction or for considering to consult them to an expert. Many systematic systems for diagnosing and classifying Alzheimer's and Alzheimer disease and other dementias are also available for use in Korean population. Here you can see some examples of assessment tools for dementia which were clinically validated with Korean population. For example, the first one, the CRAD battery, which was developed by the consortium to establish a registry for Alzheimer's disease and is one of the most widely used assessments, has also been adapted to be used with Koreans. The last two assessments here, IQ-CODE and K88, have had often used in various clinical settings to identify earlier stages in the disease through interviewing with potential patients' families and friends on identified person's possible cognitive decline from prior state and interference with his or her daily life. Of course, these do not comprise a complete list of clinically validated assessments for use in Korean elderly, nor are equally valid and reliable for different groups of Koreans. However, I want to mention that Korean population has been increasing, and this trend seems to continue in this century. Psychologists and health practitioners in the United States are more likely to encounter clients who are born and brought up in Korea. It would be important to be aware of how cognitive impairment or dementia is detected and diagnosed, or more generally cognitive processes are assessed in Korea, and what testing instruments are available and suitable for assessing Korean or Korean-American clients. Last, I would like to briefly mention some issues in assessment of dementia with the Korean population. Test items, format, or administration should be carefully reviewed and adapted, culturally and demographically appropriate. Test results also need to be scored and interpreted with the characteristics of the Korean population in mind. Especially lower education level seems to influence the cognitive screening. Dementia is a general decline of pre-existing cognitive capacities. The elderly in low education group may not have developed their cognitive capabilities sufficiently, and the sensitivity to dementia assessment procedure could be lower for the low education group. It is also very important to develop tools to detect early dementia or psychoeducate early signs of dementia to be able to be diagnosed for early detection of the disease. The early detection will enable patients to receive proper treatment earlier and better, and their caregiving families to reduce the great burden of dementia care. Informant interview or informant-based measurement of early dementia may be also helpful for older Korean Americans. Now I'm going to move to next section about Korean family caregivers for dementia patients. This section will include factors affecting Korean caregivers with stress and challenges of informal caregiving for Korean immigrants and what to do with Korean family caregivers. Each ethnic racial group displays a different set of strengths and vulnerabilities that can serve as a guide to what requires special attention during caregiver assessment and treatment. For Koreans, strong beliefs in filial obligation, language limitations, and low levels of acculturation and health literacy may be present. Again, this is not true across the board, but when these factors are present, their combined influence appears to make caregiving more stressful because they are less likely to use formal caregiving or support system. Korean American caregivers are often reluctant to openly admit their distress, relying instead on more indirect means of expression. Those who have limited knowledge of English for both reading and writing also have less accurate information about dementia, less access to the healthcare system in general, and use fewer formal support services. Cultural beliefs and practices such as strong family ties and religiosity can buffer and protect caregivers from negative health outcomes of caregiving. However, other cultural premises such as filial obligation, familism, and face-saving carry special hazards. As mentioned by Dr. Lee, Korean-American family caregivers with dementia continue to depend on informal caregivers, usually female family members. Korean family caregivers are predominantly first-generation immigrants and are often left without systematic help. This is what they are experiencing in caregiving situation. Korean immigrant caregivers who have a strong sense of filial obligations are reluctant to seek assistance from outside of home, and the lack of sufficient resources exists. there is also strong social stigma associated with seeking outside help. Moving to next box, dissatisfaction with mainstream healthcare system is also related to reluctance to use formal support among immigrant Korean caregivers. Language and food were the main barriers to adequate and satisfactory service. Even when the language was not an issue, Korean immigrants are often ambivalent about the use of formal services, and use of such services were seen as a last resort. They tend to think U.S. care providers cannot understand Korean caregivers. Even though more facilities with Korean-speaking nurses, practitioners, and staffs are available than before, Korean caregivers talk about being unable to find the culturally acceptable adequate alternatives. Establishing Korean shelters or nursing homes and training Korean home health aides is greatly needed. And help from Korean volunteers would be a good strategy to help Korean immigrant families in elder care. Mainstream agencies can recruit and train qualified interpreters or volunteers and offer ongoing transcultural education for existing professionals. In addition, information can be provided in Korean language to help Korean immigrant caregivers access to formal services. These common themes related to caregiving situation among Korean immigrants were already covered by Dr. Lee, but I am going to quote a few comments made by real Korean family caregivers in dementia caregiving situations. It is a burden because I have to earn money. However, does not mean I'm unwilling to take care of parent. My families get angry rather than soothe me. They say, can't you endure even that little thing? I don't want my children to take care of me. I want an independent life with dignity. I don't want to be left alone in an empty house. It would still be best if adult children can take care of their parents. Formal services cannot provide love. They could not speak, they could speak only English and provided American food only. But she couldn't eat them. She had eaten Korean foods for almost 80 years. Then what can we do with Korean family caregivers? There are kind of few recommendations. We can try, recognize, assess Korean family caregivers' risk of negative experiences and adverse consequences for their own well-being. Also, we can try understand changing cultural norms such as coexistence of filial piety and filial autonomy and life context of Korean family caregivers. Also, we can try provide education and intervention to enhance coping skills in relation to caregiving and to promote caregivers' well-being. Also, we can try identify and develop more culturally appropriate support services.
All right, this is John DeMario at the Stanford Geriatric Education Center. I'd like to thank Dr. Kwan and Dr. Lee for their presentation today. We're going to still have them on the microphone here. We did want to invite you to ask any questions. We did receive a couple questions already, and we did want to invite you, though, if anyone else wants to ask questions, to go ahead and use the chat window on the left to ask questions. The first question we had is from is regarding the earlier section where we discussed characters of Korean culture. There was a discussion about filial piety. And we just want to get a little bit more detail about what are the three concepts related to filial piety.
Okay, I can repeat that. Maybe I just passed too fast. The three values related to filial piety could be respect for parents and family harmony and sacrifice for parents. I will repeat that again. Respect for parents, family harmony, and sacrifice for parents. I hope this answered your question.
Great. Yeah, and if we need more elaboration, maybe on a particular concept of that, just use the chat window and let us know if that answered the question enough, or if we want a little bit more detail about that. We do have another question asking about the concept of, there was a discussion about the terms of dementia and Alzheimer's, and maybe we can go into a little bit more detail about how to use that appropriately, because there is a difference between dementia and Alzheimer's. So.
Right. Hi, this is Sang Lee, and I'm going to answer Nancy's question about choosing a term. Yes, it sounded like dementia could be used to refer to AD in non-clinical setting. Yeah, I agree about that. But at the same time, I also agree that Alzheimer's disease is one form of many dementias. But at the same time, AD is the most common type of dementia. So my experience with studying with Korean American population, dementia for sure are more recognizable. And when I asked them to actually try to describe dementia, actually they described Alzheimer's disease. So if you're dealing with non-clinical population, dementia might be at least more recognizable.
Great. And going to the next question, again, if there's any follow-up you want to do, just use the chat window or we can follow up afterwards. We do have another question asking, how involved, regards to working with the church and the community, helping caregivers in that sense, how much involvement do we see in this community with regards to the church and religion?
I'm going to give an answer to this question from kind of practitioner's viewpoint and how to help caregivers rather than what caregivers can do in the church. I have experienced recurrent subjects family caregivers, and I found that church is a kind of one of the actually the outreaches. So I can actually meet them and give my message or even advertise my research. So I think, because they do have access to churches, at least a few days a week. So I can, we can go and give information and psychoeducations. So just to give the kind of idea that church can be an outreach. We can just meet Korean caregivers. Actually, it's a good idea for us. And how the church actually can be involved in helping caregivers, is one of my question marks at this point. So. Definitely, they are very, religious group, and usually they are very exclusive, to let others come in and do things, especially non-religious stuff. But we should think about how we can work together with, the churches, Korean churches, to help out and to reach, Korean caregivers.
Great. And we have another question asking about the MMSEK measure. I guess we'll have to email. Maybe would Dr. Kwan be the one to follow up with that? I guess that'd be the one we could. Probably what you do is if you want to contact us, my email directly, and there'll be more information on your handouts on how to contact me, and I'll forward it on to Dr. Kwan if there's any questions about those particular measures. Let's see. We have the next question is about knowledge of Alzheimer's disease beyond awareness. A little bit more detailed information about that. Just either you want to answer that question about how much knowledge do Korean Americans know about Alzheimer's disease beyond awareness? For example, about symptoms and prognosis.
I can answer that. Hi, this is Sang Lee. I can answer that based on one of my research project, and part of the research was asking their level of knowledge about the symptoms, and what I can recall from off the top of my head is they are well recognized about memory related symptoms or judgment related symptoms, but they show relatively lower awareness about behavior related symptoms and also personality changes.
And the last question we have is asking if there are currently any education or intervention programs for caregivers. Whether you want to respond to that now or maybe.
Well, this is Yu Kyung Kwan, and I might be wrong, but as far as I actually searched out, there is no single psychologically oriented intervention program to help caregivers' well-being. And but there are movements and awareness that they do need interventions and educations in terms of enhancing their well-being and ways to getting support from outside.
Yeah. This is Sang Lee. Maybe not just for the caregivers, but not ongoing, but like there was one-time educational event for particularly geared for Koreans about knowledge and resources for Alzheimer's disease and dealing with Alzheimer's disease in the LA area. But I agree with Dr. Kwan saying that maybe not about ongoing and consistent effort, particularly for Korean caregivers.
And we have another question that just came in. I guess, let's see here. I guess it's a follow-up question to understand using the term dementia. When you noted that 100% of the surveyed participants in this data that you presented earlier understood the word dementia, were we referring to the English word dementia or a Korean equivalent translation of dementia?
Yeah, Korean equivalent translation. Okay. So the survey was asked in Korean. Yeah.
Okay, great. Another question came in. Developing a partnership with Korean churches to promote awareness and knowledge about mental health in general has been rather challenging. What has been your experience? Have either of you any experience working with the Korean churches in terms of developing dementia?
This is Yu Kyung, Yu Kyung Kwan, and I can answer that. I totally agree with you at first. I have never done any intervention program or anything for caregivers, especially at churches, but I've just started actually recruiting subjects of Korean American family caregivers. And definitely I contact the churches, and I am actually going to churches to advertise my research, and sometimes I do seminars on dementia and even dementia caregiving and advertise my research. Even just to do that part was kind of challenging in terms of getting time and place and getting permission from the extra pastors, etc. So I don't think it is easy, but it's worth trying, because it's just a good outreach, because many Koreans go to church and in Korean community, so it is worth trying. That's what I think.
It's interesting, because we do have another follow-up question that's very similar to the idea of doing, I guess maybe the concept of doing outreach and trying to reach out to the community. We often refer to the church, as a method. But we have another persistent. Actually, maybe if you want to take a look at that question over there, it's on that screen there. This is a Korean advocate. One of the participants here is asking a question of, as a Korean advocate at the Alzheimer's Association, she's been contacting the Korean community and churches to do outreach, but finds it's very hard to open the door when talking about dementia. Do you have any suggestions? Maybe it may just kind of follows up what you already said, but maybe if there's any advice that you want to add to it. I think maybe you already addressed some of it, but if there's any advice on that, do we want to go any further with that, or maybe just leave it at that? You find there's their venues or besides the churches, or is that usually their best outreach method?
Definitely is one of the outreaches, actually. Mm-hmm. And there's several Korean agencies, such as in this community.
Could you repeat that again?
Church is definitely one of the outreaches, and there are several actually places we can go and to contact with family caregivers. Such as Korean agencies, such as CACS, Hanmi Bongsahwe, or senior citizen centers, and several smaller big meetings around this community. So definitely it's worthwhile actually trying and going in them and meeting the people over there. That is kind of my suggestion. And they usually say, I really know that, I don't need to hear this. Definitely, it is related to a kind of, their kind of stigmatization, reluctance, and kind of shame. and face saving. So all these kind of culture experiences in a culture characteristics are related to this kind of attitude. So, but well, once they actually come to realize and the importance of in actually psychoeducation support, they can change it actually. So always there's kind of relation between, you know, the belief and behavior. And sometimes this is what I think, to reduce the, you know, discrepancy between those two, it's better to sometimes work on behaviors and give some kind of benefits, right? Give some kind of the inputs or the incentives, and they can see it, they can feel right away. It can be a good way to change their belief. So for it, going back to, you know, actually the church as outreach, it's a good idea to talk with pastors or community leaders or church, you know, leaders, and to explain, you know, the purpose of your doings. Then they, once they understand, they will let you come in and do, you know, things. Then that way it will be easy, quite easy, a good way to access, you know, the real people and present your thoughts and try to change their awareness and knowledge, whatever. So right. That is kind of my position.
That's good advice. And we just wanted to follow up on an earlier question about the using the term of dementia and Alzheimer's again. Is the definition, what does the Korean word for dementia mean? Is it direct translation or is there a slight variance?
Dementia can be translated as 치매. So it is composed of two Chinese characters. But right now I can't recall exactly what each word means. And I think I can get back to you about that. Yeah.
Okay, great. And let's see. Well, I guess actually, since we're on the topic here, I mean, do we find, is the term, you just referred to the characters themselves, is this a more recent word, or is this does it go back to a, you know, for example, in Japanese, a new word was created to get away from the negative implications associated with various traditional terms explaining the illness. So is this a term that still carries some stigma in the translation, or do we...
I think the dementia, which can be translated 치매 in Korean, it has been used like for a very, very long time. And unlike in Japanese context, I don't think there's any new term describing the situation.
Okay, great. And okay, great. I think that answers everything. We did have a suggestion from a participant on some resources in the Los Angeles area, so that's great. We'll put that up on our email.